Finding a balance between teaching and my other grad school responsibilities was quite the challenge, but these 7 ways of strategizing my schedule worked out really well. So there are a lot of ways that you can organize your time to make sure that you're finding a balance between teaching and your other responsibilities as a grad student. The 7 recommendations I have, some are actually very general to anybody who needs help with tracking your time and being more organized, but then there are a few that are specific to those who are teaching while in grad school. And so to begin, I want to talk more about the more general tips that I have for organizing your time and finding a balance. So my first tip is to time block. Now you might have heard of time blocking before, but if you haven't, to put it simply, it's blocking out your time so that you have certain amounts of time in the day where work gets done, but the rest of the time you're free to do whatever you'd like. So for example, let's say you teach on Tuesdays and Thursdays, you might teach in the morning, let's say from 10 to noon, then you can say, okay, well I'm taking noon to 1 for lunch, and then from 1 to 3, I'll get work done every day, Monday through Friday. Or you might say, well, I teach Tuesdays and Thursdays, so on Monday as on Wednesdays, from the same times that I usually teach, that 10 to 12, I'm gonna get work done. And so it's every morning that I'm doing work for my teaching responsibilities. And so you block out a certain amount of time in the day to get your work done. So if you're a morning person, obviously you'd wanna schedule these in the morning. If you're a night owl, the reverse. But basically figuring out what blocks of time you have that you can designate for work, and so the rest of the time you designate for fun or for relaxation or for eating or for exercising, etc. And so I do recommend figuring out, okay, look at your schedule and decide at these times of the day, I'm gonna get certain types of work done. From 10 to 12, I'm gonna do more teaching stuff and lesson planning on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday because I teach Tuesday, Thursday at the same time. So I kind of had that similarity. But then from 1 to 3, I'm gonna get my coursework reading done or my homework done. And from 3 to 4, I'm gonna kind of do things for my service responsibilities because I'm part of a committee or you're volunteering at a library or whatever the case may be. Maybe you have lab work. Well, do you have designated lab work that you're required to do at certain times, or can you pick the times that work best for you? And so this way of time blocking also connects to my second tip, which is batching your work. So you might say, okay, well, I'm gonna time block 10 to noon just to get work done. And you might do 15 minutes of lesson planning and half an hour of writing a paper and 10 minutes of emails. And you just have that block of time for work, but you're not actually organizing what type of work you're doing. With batching, you decide, well, from 10 to 12, I'm doing teaching responsibilities. From 1 to 3, I'm doing coursework responsibilities. From 4 to 5, I'm doing my email, any email that I have on my academic account. And so that's batching your work rather than just time blocking work that you have to do, but not really organizing what type you're focusing on. So I do recommend doing both steps, not just blocking your time, but also batching it. Personally, I recommend batching in similar and symmetric ways. So like I mentioned before, if you teach at certain times on Tuesdays and Thursdays, then on those times, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, if it's possible, if you don't have meetings, for example, then do your lesson planning and your grading during those same times. So you get into a rhythm of, okay, from 10 to 12, this is what I do. I do teaching stuff, right? If you have class from 5 to 8 on Mondays, Tuesdays, and Wednesdays, well, maybe Thursdays and Fridays, you don't want to work that late in the afternoon, you'd rather do it in the morning. But you might be someone who likes asymmetry, and so you have that going into it. 5 days a week, I work from 5 to 8, but the mornings I have off for me time, for exercising, for walking around campus, from meetings, etc. And so figure out not just time blocking, but also batching your work. Okay, so you have your time blocks that you want to get work done, and you have your batching decision made, what type of work you're going to be doing during those individual blocks. My third tip that's more general to anybody, not just grad students who are teaching, is to find either an accountability partner or an accountability group that you can have as a support for getting your work done as you say you are. So for example, there are a lot of Facebook groups that you can join that are for grad students or for writing, etc. So I Should Be Writing is a great one for academics, especially academic women. But there's also, you can make your own group with your classmates that you just met or your coworkers, etc. So you might have just one partner that you decide, okay, well, every Sunday we're gonna text each other our goals for the week, and every Saturday we're gonna tell each other if we accomplished those goals or not, right? You can also have a writing group that you're a part of that you meet once a week or twice a week to get writing done. You can do this in person, but you can also use apps like Zoom or just opening up Skype or FaceTime and writing during the same time, but in different locations. And so I do recommend having someone, one person or a group, to kind of be that support system that's saying, well, you said you put this in your calendar, but did you actually accomplish it? Are you actually doing it? And so I do think external accountability can be very helpful to keeping a balance. Because if you say, I want to get all my work done by 5 p.m., and you have someone that you have to text at 5 p.m. every day saying, I did it or I didn't do it, well, then you're more likely to actually accomplish it, and then you have the rest of the afternoon and evening to do whatever you want to do that's not work. And so, again, definitely find either one person in your life, or you can find groups online to help you keep organized and keep you going with your projects as you say you're going to be doing in your time blocking and your batching of the work. Now, while you might be texting or emailing or calling your partner or your group and saying, this is what I plan on doing, my fourth tip is actually having a specific journal or app where you take all your teaching responsibilities and have it in one location. And so in this case, you'd have a teaching journal, basically. And so I have a whole blog post that I've linked below that talks about the benefits of a teaching journal. But put simply, it's an easy way to keep all your teaching notes in one place. So if a student or a classmate or a coworker or an admin asks you a question about what you've done in your class or are planning on doing, you have one central location where all that information is placed. And so, of course, you might have digital files on, let's say, Google Drive, where you keep all your assignment sheets and your homework assignments and your PDFs that they're going to be reading, etc. But you also have either a physical notebook or digital notebook where you have all your lesson plans, your syllabi, either written out or copied and pasted into your physical notebook or just snapshotted and put into your digital one. And you can just say, well, here on this page, I wrote down exactly what I did last Tuesday, and here on this page are my plans for next Thursday, etc. So you can have your students' assignment sheets in there, you can have an attendance sheet, you can have information on either accommodations for your students or just what majors they have, so you have that information at hand very easily, rather than having to go online and finding that out. And so definitely my fourth tip is to have one journal where you have all your teaching information placed. And so you might have, again, your supplementary readings and your assignment sheets, etc., in a digital folder, but you have all your notes and your lesson plans and your reminders in one central location that's easy to access and navigate. All right, so my next two tips are very specifically for teachers and their responsibilities in grad school. So the first one is to scaffold your courses to make it work well for your schedule. And so as a grad student, my assistantship equated to teaching two courses each semester. Now often, the two courses were the exact same. So for example, I would teach English 101 twice to just different students. But I've also had semesters where I was teaching two different classes, English 170 and English 128. Whatever the case may be, really work out your schedule so that you've structured it where grading doesn't become overwhelming at the same time. And so I have a whole series on planning your semester and making sure there's actually a whole video and blog post about the schedule in particular. But let's say, for example, you're teaching 101 twice. In that case, it wouldn't work out well to change the deadlines of the same assignments because, you know, you're gonna have to reschedule how you actually teach the material, right? So if you have the deadline for unit 1 week, and then in your other class, unit 1 is due the week after, well, how are you changing how you teach the same material to make that work? It wouldn't make much sense. So you do want to keep the schedule the same if you're teaching the same course, even if it's a different students. However, you want to figure out, okay, well, if unit 1 is due on this week, I know I'll need at least 2 weeks to grade it, most likely, because there's a lot of work involved in that first unit. Whereas, let's say unit 2, maybe it's a smaller unit that leads to unit 3, I only need a week to grade that one, and so I can keep that in mind when building my schedule. And so you always want to consider, how can you scaffold your larger assignments so that grading doesn't become a major hassle, right? Because if you have unit 2 requires a proposal that you have to approve, but unit 1 is going to take you a while to grade, you don't want the proposal in unit 2 to be due too quickly because you're still grading unit 1. And maybe they need that feedback before they can successfully achieve unit 2. Right? So in that case, you want to make sure the proposal is due maybe in the third week of the unit or the second week, so you have more time to grade. And so you want to see, how do all the units or all the projects work together to make sense for your grading schedule? Because again, you have your own coursework to worry about, most likely, if you're in your early years of grad school. And so you want to make sure your coursework comes first, because you need to succeed in your work before you move on to your exams or writing dissertation or whatever the case may be. And so you won't know your schedule in your courses, the ones you're taking, until the semester begins. But you can plan out and give yourself a lot of room in between the units you're teaching yourself, so that you know, no matter how much coursework I have, I gave myself plenty of room to grade these units for my students before the next one is due. Now, on the other hand, if you're teaching two different types of courses, so in my example, English 170 and English 128, in that case, I do recommend changing how your deadlines are due, because you're teaching two different courses already. So for example, unit 1 for 170 might be due on week 4, but then unit 1 for 128 will be due on week 5, so that you're not grading all of them the same weekend or during the same week. You have some wiggle room in between. So again, you might decide, you know what, I'd rather have the deadlines the same week for both classes, and I'll just do tons of grading during that weekend or week, and it'll be over with. If that works for you, then go for it. But personally, I believe in, at least in the first time around, scaffolding it so that you may be doing grading constantly, but you're not overwhelmed with how much grading you're doing at one time. And so carefully consider how the scheduling works well for the individual courses that you're teaching. And that leads me to my sixth tip, which is basically figuring out which types of assignments you want to include in your classes that work well with a busy schedule. So you know, no matter what, if you're taking coursework while you're teaching, you're going to be doing a lot of work throughout the whole semester. So how can you make your teaching load lighter? You consider what assignments you assign. Because if all your assignments require very detailed individual feedback, you're gonna have a lot of time spent with grading and assessing the student work. But if you give a variety of types of assignments, you can lessen that impact. So for example, when I teach English 170, which is literature for young children, to education majors, I include exams, I include short writing pieces, I include career projects, sometimes I include reading quizzes. And so that variety has different types of feedback. The reading quizzes, is the answer correct or incorrect? The long papers require individual feedback, right? The exams just require, again, correct or incorrect. And so I can balance how much time it takes to grade, because they require different amounts of feedback. And so if you're someone who teaches a course like mine, the humanities, with a lot of writing assignments, you really want to consider, well, do I want to assign them 3 long papers throughout the semester, so I'm grading 30 or 60 papers at a time? Or do you want to say, well, they have one long paper, but then they have either some type of outline or mind mapping of a concept early on the semester, and they have a presentation next about their idea, and they wrap up with the long paper. Well, the amount of feedback that a mind map or outline takes and a presentation is much shorter than the long paper. And so you make sure that you don't have constantly a lot of individual feedback to give in that class. And so choosing which assignment types to use is really central. And again, I have a video and a blog post about that element of your course design that I'll link below in the description box. And then my seventh tip is, again, more general to anybody in grad school, not just those who are also teaching, but it's definitely recommended for those who teach and do coursework. And that is to take actual breaks throughout the week. So this can come in different forms. Maybe you work really hard Monday through Fridays, but you actually take the weekend off from doing work. Saturday and Sunday are just for you, right? Or maybe you're someone who works from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., almost like a regular job, but then after 5 p.m. every day of the week, you have free time on your hands. And maybe the weekends you do work still from, you know, 9 to 5 or noon to 5, but then you still have those afternoon and evenings for yourself as well. You definitely do not want to burn out early on or later on in your grad school experience. So if you're someone who's like, well, if I'm not doing work, something, I'm doing something wrong, you really don't want to have that mentality, because it's really going to drain you as the semesters continue and as you move on to the next stage of your academic or non-academic career. And so there's this element of, I know I should be doing something, but you want to really push back against that and say, I know I should be taking care of myself. And that means taking breaks throughout the week. And so you want to decide, either when you're time blocking or when you're batching your work, when are you actually taking actual breaks that include no consideration of your academic life? So you're going to the gym and you're just enjoying the gym. You're going to get coffee with a friend and you're not talking about your schoolwork or about your upcoming exams or about the classes you're teaching. You're talking about whatever you want that doesn't have to do with academia. So you really want to give your mind a rest and your body a rest, so you can have a balance throughout the years. And so that's my final tip. And again, it's definitely, I'd say, the most important of these 7, because you don't want to leave the grad school experience feeling so drained that either you can't continue with, let's say, your PhD, if you're currently a master's student, or if you say, you know what, I went through all this of getting my PhD, but I can't stand the thought of staying in academia because I'm just constantly burned out because I never took any breaks. So you really want to figure out, how can you balance, yes, getting your work done on time, but not just constantly working and not thinking of yourself as a person outside of your work as a teacher, as a student, as an academic. All right, so those are my 7 tips for making sure you balance your teaching responsibilities with the rest of your life in grad school and outside of it. Next week, I'm going to do a follow-up and talk more about, just in general, how to balance academia and non-academia responsibilities or just life. So it won't be so much about teaching tips as these last tips were, but more just, well, how do you get exercise done when you have so much work to do? Or how do you make friends when really you're just going to be surrounded by your fellow grad students? Are there tricks to making friends outside of academia, for example? So I do have some advice about that as well. And if you're interested in that, make sure you subscribe to this channel so you don't miss the notification next week. If you found these tips helpful, I would appreciate you clicking the like button below and letting me know. If you have any questions or your own advice on teaching tips or tips just in grad school, please go ahead and leave them in the comments, because I would love to have more information on how you succeeded in finding a balance with your teaching load and your non-teaching responsibilities as a grad student.